depend on technology. Oh, don't do that. You find yourself saying things like, oh, don't do that. Or running back to your office to get the computer because for some reason, this doesn't want to do it today. So just put that over there. Some of you may be wondering about the reading this morning. Sirach is a part of the collection of books in the Bible known as the Apocrypha. These are books of wisdom sayings and stories and prophetic writings that are considered to be informative and are important as to matters of living right, but are not thought to be authoritative in matters of doctrine. They're generally found in between the Old and New Testament and more often in study Bibles, you know, those big thick ones, than in the pew Bibles or personal Bibles you might have gotten when you were baptized. They are included in the lectionary, the one that is used in many Protestant churches, including this one, and they are part of the selection of scriptures that I get to choose between some weeks as one of the Old Testament selections. They're believed to have been written sometime between the last of the prophets and the birth of the Christ, which is kind of backed up by the fact that they mostly tell the story of what happened between the last of the prophets and the birth of Christ. So they figure that's about right. I'm really very fond of some of the readings to be found in this particular book. My very favorite is one I use for folks who don't want to cooperate with their doctors. It ends with the word, "He who sins against his maker will be defiant toward the physician." If they are in the hospital and I'm reading that to you, it's because you're not being behaved. And I heard. Now, just so you know, all of today's passages talk about good and evil, obedience and disobedience, the choice between life and death. I chose this particular reading because I really just like how plainly the dichotomy was stated in Sirach. If you choose, you can keep the commandments. That's kind of pretty simple, basic, I thought. The reading in Deuteronomy chapter 30, verses 15 to 20, says basically the same thing, but somewhat less clearly. It says, "See, I have set before you today life and prosperity, death and adversity, if you obey the commandments of the Lord your God. You shall live and become numerous, and the Lord your God will bless you in the land that you are entering to possess. But if your heart turns away and you do not hear, I declare to you today that you shall perish." The problem with this reading is it also sets up the concept of if you do the right things, you will be rewarded, and if you do the wrong things, not so much. It was this concept that the book of Job was written to address because bad things do happen to good and obedient people all the time. When I was a student at Chapman University, I said to my advisor one time, apropos of I don't remember what, it must have been God's will, it was meant to happen. Whatever happens is meant to happen. And he asked if I really believed that, and I said, well, yes. And then he said, well, do you think God meant for you to be a drug addict? And did God cause all the bad things that happened in your life before and during and after that time? And I said, well, of course not, because God is good and loving, and one of the greatest gifts God has given us is free will. And about that time, my voice sort of drifted off, and I realized I was busy believing in two opposite things at the same time. That's not terribly unusual. Lots of us believe in contradictory things at the same time. But in my case, the next thing I knew, I had agreed to do my senior project on free will. And so I spent the next 3 months researching, discussing my research, and writing my thesis. I still have it, if anybody wants to read it. Talk about blood, sweat, and tears. For some reason, he assigned me a book that generally is only given to grad students. And some of you know that I am not a math person at all. But I had managed to take a math that included logic, which is very cool kind of math. I liked that kind of math. This text was so dense in its philosophical understandings that I actually had to take notes in mathematical notation. It was that bad. So anybody who wants to read my thesis, you know, it's in my office. But that work has been incredibly helpful to me. One man used to ask me all the time if I believed that God has a plan for everyone. You see, he was especially worried about children who are killed in war zones or die from horrible preventable diseases or die from hunger. He wanted to know what kind of God makes a plan like that for somebody's life. You know, that really, really bothered him. Another man who had once been a very active member of his congregation told me he quit church when his teenage son was killed by a drunk driver. He couldn't figure out why. He couldn't forgive God for taking his child like that. Even though he understood the concept that the drunk driver had made a decision to get behind the wheel after way too much to drink, he still couldn't get past the belief that God could have stopped it if God only wanted to. He couldn't accept that God's plan for his son was to die at age 17 because some dude decided to drive drunk. I do, in fact, believe that God has plans for all of us. But sometimes other people's decisions, or our own, or natural disasters, interfere with those plans. And because God is not a puppet master, God's plan doesn't come to fruition in those cases. I don't believe that God's plan is for children to die of preventable diseases or in a war because one group of people wants some special rock that is on the land of some other group of people. I believe that God has a magnificent plan for everybody's life. But droughts and wars and decisions by governments continue to kill children and cut short God's plans for them. And an individual's bad decision killed that young man and many others like him and destroyed the magnificent plans that God had for that life. This is not to say that God's not all powerful. God is more powerful than we can possibly imagine. God created everything. Amazingly, we can't even imagine what that is, but I believe strongly that God gave us free will and that we get to choose between good and evil, life and death, blessing and curse, and we get to make those choices every day, time after time after time. And because God has given us that gift, I believe that he feels it necessary to allow our decisions to bear whatever fruit they will. I believe that because God has given each of us that choice, when my bad decision impacts somebody else, as it often does, I have to live with the consequences of that decision. I find this passage in Sirach says it so much better than any other reading I have come across. First, we make the choice to be obedient or not, and then it says, he has not commanded anyone to be wicked, and he has not given anyone permission to sin. God is no puppet master, and he wants us to do what's right, but we have to make the choice to do God's will or not. It was never God's plan for me to become a drug addict, and while maybe it's good now that I've had all those experiences, still, all those years of doing the wrong thing were by my choice. I believe that I started doing God's will when I realized that I was dead inside and I wanted to live. I believe I started doing God's will when I made the decision to change my life and that decision eventually led me here. And you have no idea how weird that is. If you choose, you can keep the commandments and to act faithfully is a matter of your own choice. He has placed before you fire and water. Stretch out your hand for whichever you choose. Be before each person are life and death. Whichever one chooses will be given. That's about as plain as it gets. Making the right choices, the obedient choices, can be really difficult. We talked about that a little bit last week. Trying to decide what is right and just can be really hard. There might not be one right answer, no one obviously right choice. Sometimes it really does come down to what will hurt the least number of people, or what will do the least harm. If the decision I make is on the side of love and compassion, then I probably made the right one. Someone else might also make a decision based in love and compassion, which is different from my decision, but still, if that's where it's based, it's probably right for me and my God in that relationship. But if the decision I make is the result of selfishness or fear or anger or hatred, then it's probably not the best choice. God's choice for the people of Israel from his very first conversation with Abram was for them to follow the commandments, to treat each other with that kind of extravagant love that he showered out upon them, and to be his hands and his feet and his mouth in the world. But unfortunately, over and over again, Israel wandered off, made the wrong choices, and eventually had to be rescued. Over and over again, God sent rescuers, judges like Samson and Deborah, prophets like Samuel, kings like Saul and David and Solomon, even foreign kings like Cyrus the Great. And then he sent someone different. He sent someone who wasn't as obvious as Samson or David or even Cyrus. He sent Jesus, an ordinary man, to simply speak God's word to everyone he encountered, to teach the good news of God's love and forgiveness, to make disciples, and to spread that word across all of the earth, to tell everybody that we have choices today, that long ago, to choose the way of God or the way of the world. He told us that we can choose to do what love demands and live, or what the world demands and die inside. I think I like it best the way Joshua said it when he faced the Hebrews on the banks of that river. Now, if you are unwilling to serve the Lord, choose this day whom you shall follow. But as for me and my household, we will serve the Lord. May we all choose to follow Jesus and serve the Lord. Amen. If